You're listening to The Streaming Wars, the podcast that discusses all of the latest happenings regarding your favorite streaming services. Find out which service is winning the war this time around.
Hello everyone, welcome to the latest episode of The Streaming Wars. I'm Dustin and Tony is with me and we are here to cover everything from April 15th through the 21st. We have a bunch of news to cover. We've got some launches, we've got some launch dates, we've got some launch content for more than one different service. So we're going to talk about that stuff later on. We also have a pretty big acquisition of Vudu from Walmart, so we'll get into that. But there is some other news with some of the mainstays of the Streaming Wars, so let's get into that. Starting off with Netflix, Netflix has bought the film The Starling at auction for $20 million, or almost $20 million. This is an interesting film, specifically because the reason why it sold was because they actually put together a script and a sizzle reel. So the fact that this is not a complete film, but Netflix bought it for almost $20 million based off a sizzle reel and a script, means they were very, very pleased with the film itself.
This seems a little ridiculous that they were able to get $20 million off of a movie for a four-minute sizzle reel. I don't know. For me, that just doesn't make any sense. How come you can judge a movie and then bring $20 million to the table to bid on it? I mean, that's a little bit, I think, crazy. But once again, I mean, that's why, I mean, Netflix just throwing money at content. So, I mean, good for them. I hope the movie's great. Just, wow, that just seems like very huge amount of money for basically not really seeing what it's going to be about. So a 4 minutes is a reel equals $20 million. That's crazy.
All right, jumping over to Prime Video. Prime Video has picked up Stan Lee's Superhero Kindergarten. It's an animated series, but it'll be starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. This is coming next spring, according to the news. It's coming spring of 2021. So it is a little ways out, but you can expect that. Amazon has also landed the sci-fi podcast, The Left-Right Game, to be developed into a series. The Left-Right Game podcast features Tessa Thompson as the lead of the voice cast, and she will actually be playing a role in the series as well.
Yeah, that's pretty cool that they were able to get her to be the lead in the series. I think that's really cool to have that synergy between the podcast and the visual medium. Sometimes some voice casts, you know, they might act, but they aren't, you know, big name actors. And so it's cool to have that synergy going on. And so once again, we're seeing podcasts being turned into, you know, different properties on different platforms. And so this is another area where they're getting pretty much content that's been storyboarded, although it might be in a different way. It might not be the traditional, like it's written up on a board and you have the different panels and scenes, but you know, you have each episode, each podcast that's come out, and that kind of gives the layout for the show. And so it's kind of cool to see these streaming services adapt to different medium, not just books or movies or comics or stuff like that, but even podcasts. So that's pretty cool.
All right, and then there was no new news for Hulu or CBS All Access. Apple TV Plus, Parrot Analytics has found that Apple TV Plus is potentially having a market share of 10%. I mean, that's not a small number by any means, but I mean, I'm sure Apple TV Plus would love to have a larger number, but okay. 10% is an interesting number.
10% of the U.S. market?
Yes.
Not the global market?
Correct.
I just wanted to put that out there. Those are, I mean, although the U.S. market is just pretty much the main player in the streaming space, there is, I just wanted to bring that up just to be clear. It's surprising, I think, still their share. I think it's good for Apple TV, honestly. I mean, I think that's a little bit obvious, but also I think that their new promotions that they've given out recently, that we've talked about on the past couple shows, delivering certain content for free, I think is definitely working. We have more people staying at home, and you know, a good chunk of people have Apple TVs, they have Rokus, and they're going to pop open the service and watch the different kind of freebies they have or sign up for the subscription. So I think this is good for Apple TV Plus. There is an interesting metric, and they talked about how Steven Spielberg's Amazing Stories that released on March 6th currently has 14.1 times the demand of the average TV show in the U.S. They have a similar metric that they quoted about Mythic Quest, Raven's Banquet, in the show. That is very interesting. Parrot Analytics is a little bit different of an analytics company. It's not, I mean, it's like Nielsen that it does analytics, but they track like social engagement, mentions on social media platforms and stuff like that. And so I think this metric's a little bit interesting, and I'm curious if that's actually going to translate to anything important. What are your thoughts on that metric when you saw it in the article, Dustin?
I mean, to be fair, I thought it would have been lower, but then I thought to myself, well, if you're just looking at the U.S. market currently as it stands, there's not a ton of players right now. Now, obviously, that's all going to change once HBO Max comes along, once Quibi's on the board for something, even if it'll be on that board at all. But then Peacock's coming too. So I thought it was maybe a little bit high, but when you compare it to the players who are out there right now, it still seems a little bit high. I mean, like, you compare Netflix, obviously dominates. You've got Disney Plus, you've got Prime Video, you've got Hulu. These are services that have been around for a very long period of time. So to believe that Apple TV has come in, doesn't have anywhere near the amount of subscribers necessarily, I should say, paying subscribers, because obviously we all know that Apple TV has a ton of subscribers based off of the fact that everybody who had a new Apple product gets a free year of the service. But the people who are actually engaging and using the service is a different story. Now, you've talked about how some of the content you've really enjoyed. I have yet to check out any of this content. At some point after everything changes with me moving and things like that, I'm planning on getting Apple TV Plus to check out a lot of these originals, and hopefully that'll be closer to the time where new seasons of the shows that were part of the launch come out. But ultimately, it's going to come down to, can Apple TV maintain that 10% once HBO Max comes along, once Peacock releases? Because I think the problem is there's obviously only so much of the pie that can go around. And while HBO Max might take a little bit of the chunk from maybe Disney Plus because they have more adult content, or Peacock might come along and take a little bit out of Netflix's or something like that, you know, you're going to see Netflix's slice of the pie go down. But I wonder if Apple TV Plus is also going to go down as well. And that's what I'm thinking is most likely going to happen, because I just don't see Apple TV Plus, as it currently stands, able to even remotely compete with the likes of Peacock, HBO Max, Disney Plus, Netflix long term, other than the fact that they just have the money bag to fund it.
I completely agree. To me, a service is important. If I remember to use it, you know, often, and Quibi, unfortunately, is a service that I just, in my daily course of life, just, it doesn't seem like I have time to fit in. And Apple TV Plus is one of them where it's just like, they have some interesting content, and I like Mythic Quest, The Morning Show. There's a new show with Chris Evans that looks awesome. Check that out eventually. But it's, you know, if I can carve time in my schedule to watch the content, then that service is important to me, and it speaks to me on a different level. It sets it apart. And Apple TV Plus, for some reason, still hasn't done that. And they're delivering high quality content, but it's just, for some reason, it's not engaging. And I think that once HBO Max releases and they have very similar quality of content that's coming out, high quality content that's just amazing, especially even bingeable with even their backlog too, it's I think that's when Apple TV Plus is really going to suffer. And so I'm curious what Apple TV Plus is, you know, 10% market share, whatever number that's going to be, or social media impressions, whatever Parrot's analytics, you know, computes. I'm curious what those numbers are going to be like 1 to 3 months after HBO Max releases, because I really think that HBO Max is Apple TV's, I think, main competitor. And it's weird that that their main competitor is a service that hasn't come out yet. But for me, that's how I view Apple TV and the greater, you know, ecosystem of streaming services, is a very high quality, a very niche streaming service of just high performance content. So I'm curious what those numbers are going to be after long term. It's just interesting to see this 10% number. I found it personally surprising. So you know, listeners, if you have some thoughts on that, please let us know, because it's still a little bit baffling in my head how it's 10%. So
all right, so then jumping over to Disney Plus, there's a show called It's a Dog's Life, which is coming to Disney Plus in May. This is going to have the voice actor behind the voice of Goofy actually going around in real life looking at dogs who have professional jobs and exploring what their jobs are. That's coming in May. They also announced that launching also in May is a docuseries focusing on the Mandalorian and how it came to be. The first episode is actually launching on Star Wars Day, which is May the 4th, and then new episodes will premiere every Friday. This is going to be an 8-part docuseries.
Yeah, it just seems that once again, Disney's writing the main moneymaker, the cash cow, and that's The Mandalorian. Although in this time, we aren't able to get more episodes of The Mandalorian due to just filming restrictions due to COVID-19, we are able to get more stores related content, Mandalorian related content about a docuseries about how it was made. And honestly, I don't usually check out these docuseries because I don't personally find them interesting. And not only is it Star Wars, and of course I'm interested, but they talk a lot about how they're going to discuss filming techniques and thoughts behind the creators of Favreau and Filoni. I mean, I personally thought that The Mandalorian was beautifully shot, and I was really impressed with a lot of their shots. And so I'd love to hear more about that. So I think this is great when your plans change and, you know, kind of life throws you a major, you know, obstacle. Okay, can you adapt? And it seems that Disney is going to adapt with a docuseries. So they don't have to really bring in a bunch of new film crews in and do stuff. They a lot of post-production. So this is really great. Good job, Disney.
And also there's been word that Mandalorian season 3 has already entered pre-production, even with season 2 further out. So it looks like their goal is by the time that they can wrap up season 2, if they haven't already, because let's be clear, we knew they were actually filming season 2 as season 1 was still premiering on Disney Plus. They could be working on pre-production to ensure that once they're able to go back to work, they can start filming right away, so that season 3 is only a year out from season 2 and they can continue releasing that series as they progress. So that's also something to be happy for too, for Star Wars fans. All right, so then jumping over to Quibi, there's a couple of new series that have been announced. The first one is there's an adult animated comedy series called Doomlands that has been ordered. There is a series called Cancelled that will star Nikki Glaser, which is being developed over at Quibi. And then there is also, Quibi has teamed up with Vox Media for a new series called Answered, which actually premiered on April 20th. And this one is answering different questions specifically about COVID-19 and coronavirus, and, you know, giving, you know, putting some myths and untrue facts to bed. The new episodes will premiere Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays up until May 4th, when they will then start releasing new episodes every single day. So just for 2 weeks, they'll release 3 episodes per week before they get to May 4th, and they'll have new episodes every weekday, similar to the vein of all the other Daily Essentials. All right, so then jumping over to HBO Max, Max Bornstein has inked an overall deal with HBO. He is the showrunner behind a Lakers drama series. And then we also have a comedy canine competition series called Hot Dog, which has been ordered for HBO Max. Then we have a number of other shows. There, as we've talked about before, Bad Robot, J.J. Abrams signed an exclusive production, his production company signed an exclusive deal with Warner Brothers as a whole company, meaning that they would be producing movies, TV shows for not just Warner Brothers or HBO or HBO Max, but all of them combined as part of the deal. So the first 3 shows from Bad Robot have been announced, and they're going to be doing an offshoot from The Shining. They're going to be doing a Justice League Dark series, and then they're also, they have one other series as well. So they have a number of series lined up, but anybody out there who thought that Greg Berlanti was the only person who's going to be doing DC shows at HBO or Warner Brothers, this shows that obviously there's other production companies that are going to be working on DC shows as well.
I am happy that we're finally getting more stuff from this deal. We first announced that J.J. Abrams and his production company signed a deal. There was some consternation a little bit in the DC fandom of what's going to happen. I think overall, I was excited just to see what projects he would take on and how much, you know, visibility he would really bring into HBO Max and into that platform. And I'm happy to see that there's finally something coming from that deal. Obviously, he's probably involved in a bunch of different other things and advisement roles and stuff like that. But I think overall, you know, a Shining offshoot, you know, Justice League Dark, I think those are good properties to kind of span the different genres and have his hand in those different fields. So I think overall, this is great. I'm looking to see more stuff that Abrams brings. I just really like Abrams as a creator. So this is a lot of fun.
All right. And then the other news from HBO Max, besides the launch date, which we'll get to because that's our main discussion for today, Warner Media has announced that HBO Max will be free for HBO subscribers at Charter. Now, you may remember we talked about how how when Peacock launches, it will be not only available for Comcast subscribers, but also be available for Cox subscribers as well. Well, Charter has inked a deal with HBO Max where not necessarily that you're getting anything for free, but if you are already subscribing to HBO through Charter Communications as your cable provider, you will have access to HBO Max as well as part of your subscription to HBO. Now, back in October, Warner Media was very clear about how they intend on signing more deals with more companies in the future. The idea is they want a bigger cut of the pie if they're offering HBO Max to the subscribers of these different cable companies. And the alternative is, of course, people unsubscribe from their cable companies being the provider for HBO, and then they go subscribe to HBO Max because it's all-encompassing, including all the HBO content plus the Max originals and all that other stuff. So the question is, how many other companies will potentially pop up as this goes forward? It'll be interesting to see because I'm not real sure there's a lot in it for the cable companies other than potentially losing out on any part of the subscription, because right now they're already getting a chunk of the subscription every single month while their customers are subscribing to HBO or Warner Media. Obviously wants these people to switch over to HBO Max because there's more money in it for them. We are just over a month away from the launch of HBO Max, so it'll be interesting to see if any other cable providers actually jump onto a similar deal as they have just landed with Charter. So we'll see.
I first read this that Charter would offer free HBO Max, and I was like, wait, what? And that's amazing. That is not the case. They're offering free HBO Max to HBO subscribers. So I think it's just good common courtesy, and I thought that would happen already. You know, overall, this is great for HBO Max that they're beginning deals, relationships with these different cable providers to get these types of deals that we've seen Disney have, we've seen Hulu have recently, you know, just other partners. So this is overall good for streaming provider and then cable relationships.
All right, so then jumping over to Peacock, as we talked about last week, Peacock has officially launched. I did not have a chance to actually play around with it, but I did watch a video online showcasing how it was working. I mean, it looked pretty straightforward to the similar interface that we saw back at the Investor Summit in January, so it's not that much different, but there is a lot of content. There's a list in the show notes if you want to check out what they have to offer. They have a bunch of stuff that they have planned for the future. Popular series like The Office, This Is Us are coming later on. They have a lot of content that they will plan on rolling out, but this is not going to be during the soft launch that they're currently doing right now. This is going to be later on down the line after it launches across the entire nation. They did, in fact, say that they do have plans to have original content for the full national launch, though most of the original content is going to end up being delayed till 2021. They did actually have teasers for a number of the content that is expected to actually launch in 2020, including the Brave New World series, Saved by the Bell reboot, sequel, however you want to call it, the Punky Brewster sequel, reboot, the Psych 2, the film, the AP Bio, the next season, Angeline. There's a bunch of stuff that they actually showcased, but the question is, this is the content, the teasers they've actually released means that this is the content that they've actually already filmed. This is the stuff that's in post-production. This is the content that is most likely to happen prior to 2021. So while there's obviously this massive production halt right now currently happening, this is the content that you're going to probably expect to see before 2021 rolls around. So if you are interested in Peacock, that's the content you can look forward to outside of obviously the large back catalog that they already have. There was also a new comedy series inspired by the life of rapper Dumbfounded that is currently in development at Peacock as well. That was the only other news piece outside of their launch. There is no niche streaming services, and as far as other streaming providers, Tubi Kids has begun to roll out on Android and Apple. Now, if you're asking yourself, what is Tubi Kids? It's basically kids content provided by Tubi. There's a ton of content that they actually have available specifically for kids. They have an app designed specifically for kids programming. This is separate from their normal Tubi app, which offers content for all ages, but this is specifically for children. All right, so moving forward, our main discussion today is going to be the announcement of HBO Max launching this May. Now, last episode, I stated that I thought it was going to launch the second to last week of May. I was off. I was wrong because they've decided that they are going to launch on May 27th, which is actually the final Wednesday of May. It just happens to be 2 days after Memorial Day. So any thoughts on Peacock potentially launching in early June? That's not going to happen. I'm sure, I'm positive at this point, Peacock will stick with their national rollout date of July, especially since they don't have a ton of original content that they can launch with. However, HBO Max will launch on May 27th. They have made it very clear what type of content they will have. They obviously, just like everybody else right now, have had production issues because of everything going on with the pandemic. Because of that, they were planning on launching with, obviously, the Friends reunion special. That's not happening. We talked about that last episode. But it is still happening in the future, just it's not happening at this immediate time. However, there is other content that will actually be launching on May 27th to include Legendary, which is a dancing reality show, the Not Too Late show with Elmo, Looney Tunes cartoons, Love Life, On the Record, and Craftopia. Out of the content that they have actually announced that is launching on May 27th, I do want to point out that this type of the specific content that they've announced is content that either can be put together very quickly or was planned very, very far in advance. Specifically, when you're looking at things that are not a reality-based show, specifically Legendary, Craftopia, these are reality shows that we've talked about before. Reality shows are very quick. You can turn those around very quickly. Disney Plus was putting out a bunch of that type of content because it's very easy to produce, very cost-effective, and they can do it very quickly. So that makes sense that they would have some of those shows ready to go. The drama that they have that launching is The Love Life, which is a series that was announced before HBO Max even had a name. This was a series, I believe, was announced back in April or May of 2019, before HBO Max had a name, which was at July of 2019, which is when they had their name. Love Life is a series with Anna Kendrick, and it feels very much in line with offerings that you would typically see on HBO, and definitely going for that younger female demographic that they said that they were going for. On the Record is actually the project that was originally scheduled to be on Apple TV Plus until Oprah decided to pull it from Apple TV Plus because she didn't like the way the project was actually put together. So HBO stepped in and bought the rights to it, and now it'll be on HBO Max as one of their launch titles. I'm not sitting here saying that HBO Max doesn't have a lot of content, but this is obviously probably not the exact lineup that they were looking for their launch. However, they have a lot of other content. Initially, they planned on having 31 different original series launching in 2020, with 50 coming in 2021, and that would include the new HBO series as well. However, I think with the production halt, they've had to kind of space some things out. There's certain projects that probably have finished all of their principal photography and have moved into post-production that could have been potentially ready for the launch of HBO Max, but I think that they're probably holding some of them because there's going to be a big gap of new content that they've actually had to put on hold because of everything going on with the pandemic. So I think that while there's not a ton of new original content here that they have, that's not to say that they don't have a bunch of content. Now, Tony and I were talking about their content prior to us recording, and you stated, there's a big pull here from HBO Max, and it's not necessarily the original content as a whole.
Yeah, for me, HBO Max is just about its backlog. It's about leveraging the HBO backlog of content and just how fantastic it is. I mean, you got Game of Thrones, you have a bunch of other stuff. I mean, obviously you could tell I really like Game of Thrones. And so it just, I'm excited for what they have and their catalog of movies and everything like that. So for me, that's what sells me the service. It's why I would pay $15 for it, is for its backlog, because it would take me forever. It'd take me a long while to binge it, just the normal thing with work and whatnot. just time. So that's why I'm excited for it. I think that's where it's going to deliver the most value right now. And for a while too, for a lot of people, is as long as it's going to get, you know, HBO, if we get the HBO library, then like you got Watchmen, you got Chernobyl that I need to catch up on, Ballers, Game of Thrones. I mean, we can keep naming names. And so I think that's what is going to sell, you know, the service is essentially it's going to be a little bit, it's more people going to be able to get HBO content easier than they ever will have. And I think that's why it's going to sell. And I think it's why it's not going to get the same amount of flack that maybe Disney Plus got, just because, you know, Disney Plus launched the service and it does have Star Wars and it's got the Avengers properties. I mean, the Marvel properties. But I mean, once again, you got what, 9 films plus 22 or the 24 Marvel films. I mean, and all those are movies. Like, that's not that much, like, that isn't not at the same time that much bingeable content. And like after you walk through The Mandalorian, like you sit there at the service and it's like, well, okay, what am I going to watch next? You know, you have those issues. And for kids, it's great. I mean, my daughter watched Frozen 2 today. She watched The Little Mermaid again today as well. And so she's been loving the service. But, you know, for me, it's just not that interesting. But for HBO Max, yeah, it's not going to deliver that much original content, or it's going to not deliver that much original content that I'm going to like, because I did see most of the trailers for HBO Max and just wasn't that sold. But that's just a personal thing, not like a, I think that there's something too horribly flawed. It's just not usually my thing. And so that's why I think the backlog is going to be the biggest selling point, and it's going to be its differentiator between itself and Disney Plus, the newer, just a new service that just launched a few months ago. And then, you know, HBO Max is because of its backlog and how it's going to be able to keep, it's going to keep adults entertained more so than I think Disney Plus is going to be. And I think that's why it is different. I think that's why it's going to succeed, where Disney Plus has kind of gotten, it's in this little weird situation right now. But I think HBO Max can weather the storm, can even weather and succeed greatly in this COVID storm because of their backlog and how many people will sign up just to watch it since they're staying at home and stuff like that. So that's why I'm excited for the service. I know that you were pushing a little bit more for some original content. I mean, I know you're happy for the backlog, but I know that you and some other people were pushing for a little bit more original content. So, I mean, that's understandable. But for me, I think HBO Max is going to kind of buck the trend of like, you need original content. But when you have a backlog like that, I mean, you can get a long way without, you know, new stuff.
I definitely agree. I mean, I agree to the sense of, yes, they have an insane back catalog. Not only do they have the entire library of content from HBO, they have a wide variety of their film library available from Warner Brothers. They've licensed out Rick and Morty, South Park. They have the Studio Ghibli films. They have all kinds of content. And honestly, like I've said before, HBO Max really does feel like a full family service. Disney Plus, like you just stated, is really designed more for children. There's not a lot of content for adults, but you will have content for adults on HBO Max. There will be content for children. Maybe not as much content as Disney Plus, because that is what they so highly focus on. But there is a ton of content. You know, we've got Sesame Street. You've got tons of Hanna-Barbera stuff and Looney Tunes and all kinds of other content, Studio Ghibli. But there's rated R films that you will be able to watch that adults will look forward to watching. So while Disney Plus isn't nearly as expensive as HBO Max, it does not offer the full family experience that HBO Max will offer. That said, yes, obviously I'd love to get more original content because I'm always looking forward to the new and latest and greatest when it comes to that stuff. But that's not to say that the library of content that HBO Max will have is not going to entice me by itself, because there's lots of shows on HBO that I have not seen that I have on my list of stuff that I'd love to see, but I just haven't gotten around to. I honestly, I'm going to go off topic for a quick second, but honestly, there's been this thing where I've had issues where I get so interested in something I see a trailer for because of all the trailers I put together. I watch every single one of the trailers that's in the show notes every single week. And there's so many things that I see in these show notes that I'm like, oh, this looks so great, but it's not out yet. It doesn't have, you know, it's coming out in a month or a month and a half or whenever on whatever service it is. And by the time it comes around, I'm not even thinking about it because it's just not something that's on my radar. And then I'll randomly like see it in passing, go, oh, I really wanted to see that. That trailer was really good. And I'll completely forget about it. And I'm really hoping that that isn't going to be the case. I know I watch a lot of content on HBO as it is without needing any more originals than they already have just from the HBO content. But I'm pumped for HBO Max. It's not a secret. When we talked about HBO Max Investor Summit back in October, I told everybody at the time, like, I'm the person who's really looking forward to this service. It's not a secret. This is, out of all the services that they have, while I'm a huge Disney fan, this is the service that I'm really looking forward to, because they are going to have such a wide variety of content. I showed my kids a couple of the trailers of the kids' content that's actually the originals, and they were immediately like, I want to check that out. I want to see that. That looks great. So, I mean, like, it's definitely one of those things where I think that it's going to appeal to the whole family and not just part of the family, which is what some of the other services out there do. Netflix has a wide variety of content. Prime Video has not as much content, but still a variety of content. And I think that HBO Max really has the opportunity here to really get into the streaming wars as the service that has another huge library of content for the entire family. And that's what's super important.
Yeah, I mean, hot take, we could say that WarnerMedia has been planning for this day for their inception of how they've done the business and the contracts and licensing out their content to a bunch of different partners. So then when the rights get reverted back, they get all this content, you know, we could play that game. But I think you kind of said on the nail of why I think HBO Max is going to, it has the biggest upside and the most potential out of any of the streaming services, just because what it brings, its backlog caters to just a huge amount of people, you know, adults of different, you know, viewing preferences, you know, more mature, more just action heavy, more, you know, romantic comedies or just comedies in general, kids, teens in between. I think that they have such a huge range that they can target. I think it's what it's going to set them apart. And especially during this time where people are going to be staying at home more, I think that's where HBO Max is going to really deliver. And, you know, we hear all the time of like, oh, you need to watch this show, you need to watch this show, you need to watch this show, where a good many of those shows are going to be on HBO Max. And if they deliver well without major technical issues, like, they could really get a lot of good publicity in the first month of launch and just really just racking up people. So I think that's why I'm excited for them, is that they have the biggest upside. I think eventually they need to focus on more original content, but for now, for this launch, really, I think for the rest of the year, they could just release what they have in terms of their library and really get a far way to go. So they have the biggest upside, and that's why I'm so excited for them when they're going to come out on May 27th.
And the other part of the announcement of their launch and all of that is that it was announced, we had talked about this before when we talked about the investor meeting, but they specifically said that a number of AT&T customers will have free access to HBO Max, and that includes a wide variety. If you want full details on who is going to potentially get the service for free, you can check it out. There's a wide variety, but it's like 10 million people that AT&T potentially could have immediately jump onto HBO Max based off of what they're offering. And even if you're not one of those people who get it for free, they're actually going to be offering like extended trials for like 30 or 60 or 90 days, depending on different types of service that you have. You can get 30, 60 to 90 days trials of using the HBO Max to get people really interested in seeing what it is, just based off of being an AT&T customer as a whole. So there's a lot of customers that will look forward to this, and there's a lot of customers that are probably going to sign up regardless of whether they're an AT&T subscriber or not. All right, so moving over to our secondary discussion, it's just a real quick one. We talked about how Vudu was being put up for sale by Walmart, and the question of the day was, well, who's going to purchase it? Vudu being a digital storefront for movies, which is not necessarily specifically streaming, but it does go alongside. It's kind of like a parallel situation to what we talk about here on the podcast. So the interesting thing is, it actually turned out that the company that ended up buying Vudu from Walmart is Fandango. Now, Fandango is majority owned by Comcast, who recently, obviously, soft launched Peacock as part of NBC Universal. They also recently purchased Xumo, which is a free streaming service similar to Tubi or Pluto TV. And now they have bought Vudu to enhance Fandango. Now, the intent in this, and we talked about this before, about where exactly could Vudu end up? Where does it make the most sense? And honestly, there wasn't a lot of options that it really could make sense. This is one that actually makes a lot of sense. Fandango has a service called Fandango Now, which allows you to purchase films. But the reality of it is, while they are linked into Movies Anywhere and they have, you know, you can have, they have a wide variety of films available through Fandango Now, they don't have anywhere near the size of customer base that Vudu has. So by buying Vudu, they can bring Vudu over, leave it as Vudu for the time being. Eventually, Fandango Now and Vudu can become its own thing. And then Fandango basically closes that gap of, they were originally just a ticket service company for films. You buy, if you're going to see a movie at a movie theater, you could buy your tickets through Fandango. That is the majority of their business. Now, having something past the movie theaters, having the opportunity to have a digital storefront and being able to sell films and make money in a different way outside of just relying on the movie theaters, it opens up a lot more doors. What's more interesting is that part of the actual explanation of this deal from Comcast is this has nothing to do with Peacock. They have no intention of bringing Vudu into Peacock or bringing Fandango Now into Peacock. You know, and while we don't know the extent of what Xumo will do for Comcast as a whole, they're looking at this as like a variety of different tiers of, you know, digital services that they can offer a variety of different customers. We heard about the Tubi deal within hotels, and there was a hotel chain that picked up Tubi to put in a lot of their hotels because it makes sense for them. It's a cheaper option than having to have the cable providers or satellite providers providing content for the hotels when people aren't utilizing all of that content that is available by having those subscriptions. So offering these free services, it closes that gap. You have the other gap of, you have a streaming service that offers free content and premium content as well. Then you also have a digital storefront that will allow you to purchase films and be able to rent them and watch them on demand. So it's kind of interesting. Then you put in line also, obviously Comcast has the Xfinity storefront where you can purchase films and rent them as well through your cable provider. There's a lot of different layers to what Comcast is clearly looking at and saying, okay, we really want to make sure that we are an all-encompassing digital brand when it comes to media content. And that's really what they are. And when you look at it, there's not a lot of other places out there that are even remotely comparable that have the opportunity to have all of these different avenues. You've got, the closest one is probably Amazon with Prime Video, because you can rent and buy films through Prime Video and immediately watch them and absorb them. But they also have original content as well. But they don't have a free service. They don't have the television service that is offered like Xumo does, or something similar to the vein of Peacock with the ongoing channels and things like that. You can add channels to Prime Video, but that's an added expense. Then you jump over to Apple TV, and they have a very similar thing where you can purchase films and rent films. And they also have original content through Apple TV Plus. But again, they don't have all of these other things. You have to add those onto the existing service of Apple TV or of Prime Video in order to have subscriptions to other channels that exist, like HBO or, you know, some of the news channels or, you know, things like that. So you can see that Comcast is really trying to broaden their reach when it comes to streaming, because they're seeing streaming as the wave of the future, and they know that cable is not something that they can rely on for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, I think this was a little bit surprising. I was not expecting that Fandango would buy Vudu, honestly. I thought either Amazon or Apple for their iTunes would have made the most sense in terms of the players out there in the streaming world. Fandango does make sense. And when I first saw the headline, and I was like, what? This doesn't make any sense. Like, why would Fandango do this? But then seeing how they're trying to kind of diversify their business a little bit, and instead of, you know, Fandango is all about selling tickets and getting people into theaters, it's okay, well, what if we can make it easier for people to watch movies like just immediately? And so it makes sense why they got Vudu. I'm happy with the acquisition. I think overall it makes sense in terms of of kind of Comcast's view of the digital media space. They are rolling out streaming platforms for their content. And then they have Universal, which, you know, creates the movies and is a studio. And then now you got Fandango now, which, you know, gets, you know, butts and seats at theaters, but then also helps, you know, when people come home, rent movies easily. And nice thing about Vudu is they really have a premium on user quality of the videos, so that people can enjoy just the high, just the beautiful colors and stuff of their service. So I think it makes sense. I think if you're going to pick a list of names, Fandango definitely would not have been the top 10, maybe in the top 20, in my opinion. Just, I was not expecting them to do it. But overall, I'm glad that Vudu is having a nice home somewhere. Fandango is going to be great. I think Vudu customers are going to be happy that pretty much not much is going to change for them. The longtime users of the service, just reading the press release, it seems that they really have a focus on making sure that the current customers of Vudu are going to be happy. And so overall, this is a good deal. It's a little bit surprising, but I mean, that's the nature of the game, is that there are people who are going to buy up the Vudus of the world for their services. So I'm happy. It's surprising, but happy overall.
All right, so with that being said, there is a ton of trailers, most of them just released in the last couple of days, for a wide variety of content that is available on all the different streaming services that we talk about here on the podcast. Outside of that, that is going to wrap up this episode of The Streaming Wars. I want to encourage everyone to follow us on Twitter for all the latest articles that we talk about here on the podcast and some articles that we don't talk about on the podcast. Also, follow us on Instagram for all the latest announcements related to latest episodes of the podcast releasing. That is where you'll find those announcements immediately on Instagram. Links for those can be found over on our website, thestreamingwars.io. If you are so inclined, you can send us feedback, questions, comments, concerns, topics you'd like us to cover on future episodes directly to us at thestreamingwars@gmail.com. And you can leave feedback wherever you are listening to this podcast. That is always greatly appreciated. With all of that being said, for Tony and myself, this has been The Streaming Wars. We'll see you guys next time. Stay safe out there.
Thanks for listening to The Streaming Wars. Check us out on Twitter and Instagram. Also, consider supporting us on Patreon. Links can be found at thestreamingwars.io.